And now a moment from the OCCULTURE archives, episode 77, Jason Louvre in Empire of Angels.
Now, I think it's important to mention the work of Pico della Mirandola as it relates to this world that Dee was born into. I know that you know of Pico's work, but for those who don't, how did his work lay the foundation for what was to come with Dee?
Yeah, so this is just absolutely critical to understand, because for most people, when we're learning about Hermeticism and Kabbalah and things like this, we're learning about it through the lens of the Golden Dawn and the people who followed on from their thinking, which, as we now know, was, you know, not particularly historically accurate. It was quite beautiful in its own right. But to understand Hermeticism, we have to understand what it was originally and where it came from. And it was from the Medici city-states during the Renaissance. So you have to understand that Europe, for hundreds of years, was, of course, in the Dark Ages. There was, you know, no access to any type of intellectual tradition, you know, following the fall of Rome into darkness. And for the most part, there was the church, and it was the church's job to, you know, shepherd the spiritual and intellectual life of Europe. And so Europeans lived, for the most part, outside of small breakaway heresies or kind of pagan survivals, Europeans lived with one story about what the world was, which is, I would say, almost impossible, but I think it actually is impossible for us as modern people to understand or conceptualize. There was one story, and that was the story that the Christian church said about what reality was.
Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to OCCULTURE, where we are back to our regularly scheduled deprogramming. Took a little detour last time out and got a bit conspiratorial on everyone, and more on that later on. But for now, I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show. Thanks for being here. I am so pleased and so honored to welcome this particular guest into the house. His name is Greg Kaminsky, and he is the host of a podcast called Occult of Personality. Greg's an OG in the occult podcasting game. I was trying to think of a good analogy for Greg and I coming together, and the best one I could think of is the first time you heard Dr. Dre and Snoop Dogg together. Greg is the podfather, or the dogfather, of occult podcasts, like I said. We'll talk a bit about how he became that, and then we're going to dig into one of my favorite topics and talk about one of my favorite dudes to ever do this damn thing, Giovanni Pico della Mirandola. Such a fascinating figure with some downright heretical ideas. And Greg is going to creep to the mic like a phantom and parse out this story for us over the course of the next hour. So sit back, relax, and strap on your seatbelt, because you've never been on a ride like this before. With a producer who can rap and control the maestro, it's time to roll another dope episode up and take a toke, but don't choke, because if you do, you'll have no clue what me and my homie Greg Kaminsky came to do. Enjoy. Greg Kaminsky, really, really appreciate your time.
It's an honor to be here. Thanks for inviting me. I appreciate the opportunity.
No problem, man. No problem. So, Greg, you are the host of Occult of Personality, and I think between the two of us, we have the major occult puns and portmanteaus covered. At least I can't think of any more, unless you can off the top of your head.
No, I think you're right.
So, regardless, I could use a lot of one-word superlatives to describe just how good your podcast is, but I think one of the highest compliments that I can give you is that you really have paved the way for shows like mine to exist. You're on my personal podcast, Mount Rushmore, And, you know, while we occupy similar space, I think we do have very different shows and styles, and maybe that's something we can chat about later. But before we get into anything, let's talk a bit about you. You know, you started your show, I believe, back in 2006, but I'm curious, you know, what exactly led to the creation of it? You know, how long and how deep had you gone down the rabbit hole, so to speak, before you fired up the microphone for the first time?
Well, thank you for that kind introduction, Ryan. It's a good question. Let's see. I was interested in these subjects, but I'll be honest, I had really little to no understanding of them from a practical perspective. The majority of my interest in it came from things like fiction, history, and an interest in religion and symbolism and things like that. But I didn't really have much of a clue about what was magic or tarot or alchemy or Freemasonry or any of these kind of things. I had really no familiarity with until probably a year or two before I started the podcast. And as I started researching these subjects more in depth, it just became clear that I could read books for years and years and years, and I was probably not going to get a more clear understanding. So I decided I needed to talk to people who knew about these things a little bit more, and figured the podcast would be a great way to do it. I enjoyed listening to podcasts, and it seemed like a natural fit because there are people I wanted to speak to who are experts and authors, and the podcast would give me a venue to sort of make the introduction and make the conversation happen. And so that's pretty much how it started.
That's pretty similar to how mine started too, man. I got into Hermeticism through the work of John Crowley, who I'm sure you're aware of.
Mm-hmm.
And that sent me down the rabbit hole, so to speak, for the first time. And then I started the podcast for pretty much the exact same reason, to just facilitate my interest in it more, to have the conversations that I was wanting to have that, you know, I really couldn't have in my own personal life, you know. So,
yeah.
Like I say, Hermeticism, you know, really spurned that for me. Was there a particular topic in general that made you want to explore this further?
Yeah, for me, it was Kabbalah and the intersection of Kabbalah and geometry and Freemasonry and magic, and how the hell did this Jewish esoteric tradition end up in basically a Christian hermetic milieu? Because it just made no sense to me. Looking at it from an outsider's perspective, it just seemed so bizarre.
That's an interesting connection and correlation. We might be able to talk about that later when we get more into, I guess, the reason that we're here to talk. But I just got another question or two up front here. You know,
of course.
Like I said, it's been about 12 years since you started the podcast. And obviously, the podcasting medium itself has exploded in recent years. You know, so much that even a guy like me can host his own show. But I'm curious, you know, what the landscape of occult podcasting was like when you first started. Were you a lone wolf back then? You know, how has the genre evolved?
That's a good question. Let's see. From what I recall, there was the Lima Coast to Coast, which I think you can still find somewhere online. Maybe hermetic.com still hosts it, the old episodes. John Crow hosted that way back in 2004, 2005, 2006, I think. And there was also the Kentroversy Tapes, which was a combination of sort of esoteric research and conspiracy research, hosted by Kentroversy, Kent Daniel Benkowski, who is no longer with us, but he was probably one of the forerunners of this as well. And then I remember there were some other podcasts I used to listen to and that featured topics that were at least tangentially interesting. Like, for example, Red Ice Radio would have Michael Tesorian on a lot, and I would listen to that. Now, obviously, you talk about the podcast landscape evolving. That's a good example of it right there. So I'd say that was pretty much, from what I recall, the majority of what was available in terms of any kind of occult or esoteric or ancient civilizations or anything of that nature.
So sort of a similar question. I'm curious how the audience for this type of content has evolved since you first started. Has it gotten larger?
It seems to have gotten much larger. And I would also say it seems like the audience has become more knowledgeable over time generally and more sophisticated over time generally. And that maybe that's a reflection of my desires, or maybe it's a reflection of reality. I'm not sure, but either way, that's what it seems like.
Well, would you extend that observation to maybe the more general occult culture these days?
I would like to, but and I think part of the issue is it's like it gets, because when things get more popular, you naturally get people interested in it as more of like an aesthetic or like a pop culture phenomena. So I think the more popular it gets, the less sophisticated and the less knowledgeable the overall audience who is interested in these subjects gets. And I think that's evidenced by the numerous and continually released introduction books on the subjects. Like every publisher is constantly putting out introductory texts on magic, tarot, symbolism, like any subject you've got. Like there's lots of intro books being released, and that seems like a continually renewing fountain. So overall, I think it's rare that people progress over time and develop like really profound practices that allow them to sort of like unfold in the way that a lot of these systems are designed to facilitate.
So you're a Freemason, right?
That's correct.
How long have you been one, and how has that sort of shaped, you know, not only yourself, but also the podcast or maybe the types of guests you seek out? You know, do you feel the need to sort of stay away from certain areas because of that? I'm just curious.
So I've been a Freemason for 9 years, and I think it's been really incredibly useful simply from gaining an understanding of a huge aspect of Western esotericism and what that involves and the history behind that. And I would say that I do not shy away from topics because of that. In fact, I think it's given me insights into topics that I probably would have ignored otherwise. An example would be Robert Sullivan's work on the Book of Enoch. I think that was a really good example of an interview that I probably wouldn't have been so keen to do otherwise, but I realized what he was bringing forward was pretty amazing research and deserved a little bit more of consideration. So I'd like to think it makes me more aware of things that I would otherwise miss, but it certainly probably means that I'm more partial to Masonic mysteries, if you will, than I would be otherwise.
Yeah, I just talked to Robert too, actually, but the Royal Arch of Enoch did come up, and that is a fascinating piece of research that he has published for sure. So definitely recommended for anybody out there listening to this. So, you know, Greg, I don't really need a specific reason to invite you here as a guest, but there was something specific that prompted this chat. I saw you post on your social media a few weeks back that you were giving a lecture at a Masonic lodge about Giovanni Pico della, and then I'm going to say Mirandola, but I've heard his name pronounced many different ways, so I'll let you settle how we actually pronounce that. I'm just going to call him Pico for short, but that name always raises one of my eyebrows. He was one of the names I came across when I first went down this particular research path. You know, I mentioned John Crowley's work. You know, I was introduced to guys like John Dee and Giordano Bruno through that, and then just naturally led to Pico's work. And, you know, just like those other two guys, Dee and Bruno, I am absolutely intrigued by Pico's character and philosophy and his work. And that's why I asked you to be here, to drop some of that knowledge on us about him and his life and his ideas. So let's dig into that and start with a summary of, you know, who Pico is and where he comes from.
Okay, great. So Giovanni Pico della Mirandola is how I pronounce his name. So he was born in 1463 near Modena, Italy, Northern Italy, to a noble family of the Counts of Mirandola and Concordia. So he came of age during the Renaissance. See, at age 14, he entered the University of Bologna to study canon law. So he was a child prodigy, essentially. He moved to Ferrara, Padua, and Pavia. He studied literature and philosophy, spent time in Florence, where he came into contact with what was now known as the Florentine Academy, which included prominent philosophers like Marsilio Ficino. And so this group is interested in the Corpus Hermeticum, Neoplatonism, and how these rediscovered ideas fit into their conception of an esoteric Christianity. And this is really Pico's first exposure to what I'd call the perennial philosophy, this idea of an ancient wisdom tradition that's perpetuated through time and cultures and comes down to us in a fractured form today. But, you know, they envisioned like an original wisdom tradition that came down from God to the first man and, you know, through the ancient cultures. So he was very much taken with this idea. And because of his disposition as an intellectual, as a philosopher, he was ravenously consuming, learning about many different systems of philosophy and knowledge and ancient wisdom traditions as well. He also became interested in the Cabala, and he learned Hebrew along with, you know, many other ancient languages. But at some point in his development, around the age of 21, 22 years of age, he basically started to formulate a philosophy of his own, which was influenced by Kabbalah and other ancient wisdom traditions. And essentially what he was trying to do was sort of unify all valid systems of knowledge that would allow him as a philosopher to then see or behold all of creation intellectually, which would then be like a stepping off point into a spiritual ascent process, which would culminate in divine union. And so his starting point was really philosophy and the ability to behold all forms of knowledge and wisdom and combine them in such a way that he could tease out the essence of each of them into a complete philosophy. So his idea was that he was going to write this out. These are his 900 theses or 900 conclusions, publish this text, and then he would debate or dispute it with anyone who wished at the Vatican in front of the church fathers. So this text is published in 1486. The plan was to do the disputation in Rome in 1487. But as soon as the Pope and the church got a hold of the text, they condemned it. They condemned Pico. They excommunicated him because there were 13 of these 900 theses that they found to be heretical. The main one said basically that the only true way to know Christ is through natural magic and the Kabbalah. So that right there was enough to put him on the list. He had to flee Rome. He was captured on the road to Paris, and that was when Lorenzo de Medici stepped in and vouched for Pico and said, if you give him to my care, he won't be any more trouble. And so he then was given over to Lorenzo de Medici, and he wrote an apology, the oration, which is now called Oration on the Dignity of Man, is excerpted from this apology. And this oration is seen as a declaration of Renaissance humanism, but I would argue it's more properly seen as a declaration of the ancient wisdom tradition and the primacy of the Kabbalah as an esoteric tradition, philosophy, if you will. that's probably where we should probably just stop right there. But I mean, that's like the what he's really known for is his oration. And he lived a tumultuous life. He was willing to put himself, not only his reputation, but his physical body on the line for his beliefs. I think he realized innately that the only way to succeed at what he was advocating, you know, this idea of complete union with the divine, was only possible if you were completely committed and willing to sacrifice everything for it. But in his oration, he talks about the idea of humanity having the capacity to not only walk with the angels, but be greater than them and unite with God. And he talks about ways to emulate specific angelic orders in order to accomplish this. And it's interesting because his prescription in this oration mirrors precisely the writings and prescriptions of Kabbalists, you know, hundreds of years later and thousands of miles away, who I'm certain have never read Pico, you know, but they were familiar with the same tradition that influenced him, the Kabbalah. And they talk about doing the exact same thing in order to unite with the divine. So I think it's fascinating the way he was able to completely correctly pull out these essential points of the ancient wisdom and present them. And he's really the father of Christian Kabbalah and essentially the father of Western esotericism as a whole, because, and we'll, I'm sure we're going to get into this later, but his writings on magic predate Ficino. His declaration about magic and Kabbalah were public, and he was willing to sacrifice himself to make that known. You know, certainly you could even argue there was no need for any sort of a rebirth of a magical tradition, because all of these ideas were already present that Pico was drawing upon. But he publicly composed these theses that explained these points, and then his oration even further declared it in really eloquent language, I would add. And I think he's such a huge influence on Agrippa, on Reuchlin, on Christian Norvon, on Rosenroth, on Paracelsus, on, you know, any major figure in Western esotericism is, you know, influenced by Pico and his work, whether they realize it or not. That's probably my introductory sketch to who he is.
The through line, you can trace it, like there are some direct connections that you can trace, and there's probably more subtle ones, like you said, of the influence that he had on a lot of people that came after him. But I did want to back up a little bit and just give some more context, because I find the story of his arrival in Florence to be pretty interesting. You know, he, like you said, he was a child prodigy, and he gets there, I believe, around age 21. I think it's 1484. And so he finds himself in Florence, and this is where he meets two people who will have a tremendous impact on not only him and his work, but also on the Renaissance as a whole and you know, general occult philosophy. And these two people, like you said, are Marsilio Ficino and Lorenzo de' Medici, or de' Medici. I'm not really sure how we should say that. But, you know, there are some other things in Florence happening too before he gets there. So I just wanted to go over those real quickly, because it does give a little more context here, I think, for people who don't know these guys. But Lorenzo's grandfather was Cosimo de' Medici. He's the patriarch of the family, a very wealthy Italian banking and political dynasty, which is a whole other subject, but a fascinating thing to research as well. But Cosimo has a professional relationship with Ficino's dad, who was a doctor. He was essentially sponsoring his work. And then Cosimo at some point then brings Ficino into his home and becomes his patron, you know, sponsoring his work. I guess the Renaissance version of Patreon, maybe, right? And part of Ficino's work is he acts as a tutor to Cosimo's grandson, Lorenzo, who we mentioned. And then Cosimo also asks Ficino, from what I have learned or read, and I'm not sure if this is accurate, but Cosimo asks Ficino to translate what would become known as the Corpus Hermeticum. Is that accurate to you? Do you know anything about that?
I mean, as far as I'm aware, I mean, I haven't actually studied it. I've just read it, like maybe you have, but as far as I know, that's basically the gist of it.
Okay. So We should also note at this time that the Hermetica and the Kabbalah, for that matter, were thought to be just as old as the Old Testament. So you could see why, you know, these wealthy families would be interested in learning more about what was in these texts, you know. But those are just a couple of noteworthy things I wanted to point out before Ficino and Lorenzo and Pico all cross paths. We should also mention that Cosimo was the one that essentially relaunched the Platonic Academy or the Florence Academy. And Ficino
That's
was
right.
Ficino was the head of this group, which, you know, seemed like it was just a group of guys who enjoyed sitting around reading and writing and talking about Plato and philosophy. I don't know if it was much more than that, to be honest. You can correct me on that. But Pico was definitely part of this group.
Yeah, he was part of it, at least for a short time. We should also mention there's a book by Amos Adelheid called Ficino, Pico, and Savonarola, The Evolution of Humanist Theology, 1461-62 to 1498. And in the book, Adelheid talks about the spiritual and political crisis in Florence, which was basically the authority of the Dominican order of the church on the question of reform, religious life, and how that fit into the broader spiritual, political, cultural dimension of things. And so Pico's work is, and this academy, and all of the things they're interested in the Hermetica, the Kabbalah, it's all arising in an atmosphere of political and spiritual crisis, not unlike our world today, I would add.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point. And it's also here, maybe, where Pico, when he's palling around with Ficino a lot, it's probably here where he gets labeled as a protege of his, and you'll find that in a couple of mainstream sources, including in some stuff from Francis Yates. But, you know, Greg, you've told me privately that Yates and these other sources are wrong, that Pico wasn't really a student of Ficino. I'm just curious why you say that, and if they weren't mentor-protege, what was their relationship exactly?
Yeah, I would argue they weren't even pals or friends at all. I think they were frenemies, to use a modern term. That's how I would describe them. So most of what I'm going to be talking about, in fact, in terms of Ficino and Pico, everything I'm talking about comes from S.A. Farmer's book, Syncretism of the in the West, Pico's 900 Theses, 1486, The Evolution of Traditional Religious and Philosophical Systems. And he has a chapter 3 in this book, which is like the, it's not, he has a translation of the 900 Theses, but prior to that, he has a commentary on the translation and an analysis. And so he has this chapter 3, which he's deciphering the thesis, but he goes into a section where he's like called Problems in Yeats's View of Pico's Magic. And this is Francis Yeats, as you mentioned, whose writing on the subject has defined Ficino and Pico for us for probably more than a generation now. So he enumerates several issues with Yeats's thesis. The first being Pico wrote his magical works before Ficino wrote his. That's a huge problem, right? He can't be a protege if he wrote his own magical works. And magical works is not the right term, because people are going to be misled when they hear that. This is written by a scholar. When he says magical works, he means works about magic, not actual magic books or how to do magic. Same with Ficino. So Pico's writing about magic before, and it's possibly up to 2 years before Ficino. So that's an issue chronologically, historically. You have a problem there. And just in terms of the sort of mentor-protege portrayal. The second point he makes is that Pico did not view Hermes Trismegistus as a magician like Ficino did. So obviously that's a huge problem. Now, Pico does write about Hermes in his theses, but when he talks about natural magic, he doesn't mention Hermes, you know, which is, I think, intentional. And I think, you know, again, as I said, I see this sort of frenemy relationship. I think these are digs at Ficino when he's doing this sort of thing. Number three, the mechanisms of Pico's natural magic differed from Ficino's. So the way that the two of them sort of see magic and the way it functions is not the same. Their models are different. So one of these things is like Pico, he was against astrology or astrological magic or astrological talismans or things of that nature, which obviously Ficino was in favor of. And he says Yeats, number four, misread Pico's view of magic and Kabbalah, oversimplifying it. And he goes through some of these theses that Pico wrote that sort of delineate the way he thought about magic. So the one I mentioned that got him in so much trouble, which was there is no science that assures us more of the divinity of Christ than magic and Kabbalah. The works of Christ could not have been performed either through the way of magic or the way of Kabbalah. Interesting. The miracles of Christ are the most certain argument of his divinity, not because of the things that he did, but because of the way in which he did them. So, yeah, his idea of magic and Kabbalah is not the way that most of us would think about magic or Kabbalah. It's a mysticism that's designed to unite with the divine, basically, and get rid of obstacles to that. Number five, Pico's magic was not operative in any simple sense. Exactly what I'm talking about here. So his ideas about what magic are really the union of heaven and earth in the mind and body of the magician. That's it. I mean, that's the best way I could describe it. And that has nothing to do with any sort of divination or any sort of operative or practical magic as we would think of it at all. So that's really the sort of delineation. And in several of these theses, he, at the end, Farmer goes through and tries to, again, show how Pico thought about this. Like some of these theses say, no power exists in heaven or earth seminally and separated. The magician cannot actuate and unite. Magic is the practical part of natural science. What man, the magus, makes through art, nature made naturally making man. The miracles of the magical art exist only through the union and actuation of those things that exist seminally and separated in nature. The form of all magical power comes from the soul of man standing and not falling. To operate magic is nothing other than to marry the world. If there is any nature immediate to us that is either simply rational or at least exists for the most part rationally, it has magic in its summit, and through its participation in men can be more perfect. So he's talking about a way of engaging with the world. He's not talking about sorcery or divination or any sort of thaumaturgy in any way. It's not even really theurgy, to be honest with you.
So I hope that
clarifies it a little bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. And I mean, if anything,
you could see Pico as a forerunner of Ficino in terms of magic, certainly in terms of Kabbalah, and certainly in terms of publicly sticking his neck out to try to communicate this.
Yeah, and I mentioned this to you privately too, but I'll share it with the audience as well. But, you know, John Crowley, well, he's came on this show and he said that Yeats's translations and portrayals are not the most accurate. So it makes me wonder, you know, why she is, I guess, you know, propped up as somewhat of an authority on such matters when we have respected writers and authors and researchers saying, when they actually dig into her work, that it's not always the, like I said, the most accurate. So this is not the first time that her work has come into question on this show, at least.
Yeah, no, I mean, she, like any scholar, myself included, has shortcomings. I think the reason her work continues to be popular, even though it may not be wholly accurate, is because of the sort of sweeping narratives that she's able to deliver. And I would also argue there's a bit of like a romanticism as well that she brings to the table that is satisfying on a more of a egoic level, I guess. I'm not trying to say these are good things or bad things. It's just, I feel like, you know, you asked why she continues to be popular. I think these are valid reasons why she continues to be popular in this area.
Yeah, I mean, she's a great storyteller, I think, is just the heart of it, to be honest. So,
yeah.
Pico's legacy, I think, is solidified in 1486 when he composes what later comes to be known as the Oration on the Dignity of Man, which you've mentioned already. And this oration also acted as an introduction to, or maybe even an overview of, his 900 theses. I know you also mentioned that, but I want to say that again, 900 theses. You know, Martin Luther has loads of street cred for his 95 theses, but here was Pico composing 900 of them. That still just kind of blows my mind. And Pico intends to put on a conference of sorts to discuss these theses, you know, with any scholars willing to come to Rome, which I think you also mentioned. And he was actually going to pay for all of their travel expenses just to get them there because, Greg, he really just wanted to have the debate, right? He just wanted to have the conversation about these ideas in his work. And I guess, you know, hindsight, it's too bad podcasting wasn't around back then, because Pico probably would have been a hell of a podcaster.
Yeah, well, he wanted to have the debate, but I think it wasn't just that he wanted to have the debate. It was that he, and Farmer, in his book, Syncretism in the West, he actually states this outright, that it looks like Pico was intending, through having this disputation, you know, this would be like the first part of his spiritual ascent, through this disputation in front of the church fathers and the Pope, because he would be philosophically beholding all of creation simultaneously through his theses, which is basically like a linguistic way to look at all aspects of the cosmos, essentially, from different perspectives simultaneously. And we can get more into how he does this, but I think his ultimate aim was really like a divine union, just as he's talking about in the oration.
So the oration, you know, it really does hit, I think, all the high points of the 900 theses. So let's just go ahead and talk a little bit about, you know, what those high points are. What are the major takeaways, I guess, from the oration from your perspective?
Well, for me, I think the major takeaways are, firstly, the way he defines humans, you know, saying that we have all the aspects of creation within us, like vegetable, animal, human, angelic, even divine. And it really depends on where we put our thoughts and our actions that dictate not only where we are, but what we are. He says humans are the only beings in creation that have this capacity to take on characteristics of so many other, or any other, beings. And this is unique, and we should take advantage of this, right? Because he says, and he talks, I forget the exact language he uses, but it's something to the effect of, we can't just compete with the angels and be content with second place, right? He's like, no, we have to beat them at their own game. And we can. That's the thing. He explains how to do it, essentially. He talks about the top three angelic orders of the seraphim, the cherubim, and the thrones, and how the cherubim correspond with the faculty of intelligence or the intellect, and how the seraphim correspond with devotion to God, and the thrones correspond with judgment in the world and right action. And he says the key is to emulate the cherubim first, because that way we develop our intellect, we learn philosophy, we know how to reason in the world, and then we can understand what God is. And then when you can intellectually grasp what God is, then and only then can you have true devotion to God. And then when you have true devotion to God, you can act with right action in the world. And so it covers the sort of behavior of these angelic orders, but this is essentially a prescription for a mystical contemplation and how to think and act in order to purify and ascend spiritually. And he also talks about magic in the oration. And he's very specific when he's talking about magic. He says there's a demonic form of magic and there's a holy form of magic. And the two are completely separate. And he says the Greeks call the first, this demonic form, goetia, but they call the other magia, magic. So he's differentiating between sort of this sorceress pact making with demons versus sort of this marriage of heaven and earth in the mind and body of the magician, sort of emulating God in a sense. And he says the two couldn't be more distinct and separate. You know, he says one is of the demonic and will take you further from God. The other was studied by Pythagoras and Plato and all of the great sages of the world. He says they have nothing in common. But to those who don't know, they're both sort of seen as magic. So he's trying to differentiate them, saying, no, this one's good and this one's not good. Which is interesting because this is the first time we encounter these ideas of like high magic and low magic. And it has nothing to do with money or status or social class or hierarchy. This is strictly on the basis of whether it unites you with the divine or puts you in a position where you are further away from the divine. That's it. So to him, there's only one way to go. I think that's a really interesting point. And then he goes on further and extols the virtues of the Kabbalah and talks about why it's so important in very profound, eloquent language, trying to convince everyone who he was hoping would see this disputation in the Vatican, who's now only going to read his oration, of the majesty of this ancient wisdom tradition that is still available to us today that we can utilize in order to unite with the divine and claim our birthright. That's what he's talking about. He's like, this is your birthright. Claim it. Like, why are you living like animals? You know, take your place where you belong. Stand up. So this is his real declaration to humanity to join him in discovering that salvation is possible while you're still alive. Redemption is possible while you're still alive. And you don't need a priest or a church to do it. So that message still echoes, you know, to us today, I think. Mm-hmm. If not now, when? I mean, this is a timeless call. This is why it's the perennial philosophy.
Yeah, there is quite a bit to unpack here and sort through. These theses then attempted to reconcile all of the religious and philosophical truths, you know, that was available to Pico. And it's important to point out too that while Pico identifies himself as a Christian, he sees the Christian truth in other belief systems. So he wants to combine all of that, which is ambitious and fascinating and kind of exciting if you're excited by this kind of thing, but it's also dangerous and disturbing to a lot of his peers and to a lot of the powerful people around him at the time. So, Greg, I was just curious, you know, what religious traditions specifically was Pico trying to reconcile?
Well, let me just go through the sections of the 900 Theses to give you an idea of the influences he was drawing from. So from the theologians and the philosophers, you have the Latins. So that would include like Albert the Great, Thomas Aquinas, John Duns Scotus, Henry of Ghent. You've got the Arabs, Avicenna, Al-Farabi, Isaac of Narbonne, Maimonides. You've got the Greek peripatetics, Theophrastus, Ammonius, Alexander of Aphrodisias, Themistius. You've got Platonists, all the Platonists, Plotinus, Porphyry, Iamblichus, Proclus. And then you've got theses that are derived from what he calls Pythagorean mathematics, Chaldean theology, Mercury Trismegistus the Egyptian, and the Hebrew Kabbalist wise men. So these are the major sections in the 900 theses that he's drawing from in order to present you with all of the valid knowledge, you know. But this is all of this stuff includes things from the Egyptian mysteries, the Greek mysteries, the Persian mysteries, as well as all of those philosophical systems, scholasticism, Aristotelianism, obviously the Platonism and Neoplatonism. He's drawing on very disparate sources and influences and trying to see the essence of them, see through them, really, to distill the essence into wisdom, really. And one of the things that really comes through in his work here is, I think he basically comes out and says it explicitly in the oration, although I certainly couldn't quote it, or you know, and he doesn't use this language. But the idea that wisdom is essentially only possible after the acquisition, everything's already been broken down, right? That's what knowledge is. Like, the unity has been shattered, and we have knowledge now. So he's essentially trying to gather it all up together, distill out the purest parts of it, and then imbibe that, if you will, and then come into a state of complete unknowing, which would be divine union, right? Because the divine, or in Kabbalah, Ein Sof, without end, like, it's, that's all there is. So there can't be a knower and things to know anymore in divine union. It's just the collapse of subject and object. So knowledge is no longer possible. There's no longer things, and wisdom becomes like an unknowing, an unlearning, an undoing. And this is also part of sort of this spiritual ascent, divine union that Pico is advocating. And it's described in a similar sense in his, I don't want to say descendants, but the Kabbalists who came later, the Baal Shem Tov, Joseph Caro, Rebbe Nachman of Breslov, they talk about a very similar sort of process of sort of self-nullification and divine union as a embracing of the great mystery, if you will.
Yeah, you know, if that's not alchemy, I don't know what is. That sounds a lot like the great work to me, Greg. I don't know about you, but...
No, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah. So let's go back to the angelic hierarchy, the syncretic angelology, I think, as you phrased it. And you mentioned the seraphim, the cherubim, and the thrones. Pico had broken these three out, and he gave them distinct characteristics as well. I was wondering if you could summarize or tell us a bit more about what differentiates these three levels here.
So the seraphim would be the top. That would be the closest to God. And they're characterized by activity that is like a ceaseless devotion to God, which may involve singing or praying or I don't know what exactly, but it's an effusive devotional outpouring for the divine. That's how they're characterized. And the cherubim, which would be the level below them and the second spot in this hierarchy, and this is originally defined, as far as we're aware, by Pseudo-Dionysius the Areopagite in, I think, the 5th or 6th century AD in his celestial hierarchy. So the cherubim are equated with this idea of intellect. They're the most like human. They're depicted with human faces. These are the angels in the Old Testament of the Bible, where the cherubim are the two angels on top of the cover of the Ark of the Covenant, facing one another with their wings coming together. The cherubim is the angel that guards the gate to the Garden of Eden, so Adam and Eve can't return, with the flaming sword. And you also see the cherubim make an appearance in the vision of Ezekiel. So these angels are really important. The ideas, they correspond with the sort of like the idea of a portal or a gate between man and God, or man and the divine. And This is the idea symbolized on the Ark of the Covenant, the cover of the Ark with the two angels together. They symbolize this portal, this gate connection. So when things are in harmony, the connection is open. But when things are in disharmony, obviously not. Now, in Jewish Kabbalah, these cherubim correspond to Yesod foundation, this ninth sphera. And this also corresponds to Metatron, which is the angelic being that used to be Enoch before he ascended. So there's a lot of implications with the cherubim. And you have to remember, Pico knows all of these when he's composing this. Mm-hmm. So when he says we have to emulate the cherubim, he already has got all of these ideas in his head as well. There's also a tradition that says the cherubim are the angels depicted on Jacob's ladder, ascending and descending in the dream. So it also shows that because they're most like human, they can go up and down this hierarchy, which is sort of the idea of Kabbalah itself, that the human intellect, again, the mind, if you will, can travel between different levels of consciousness or different sphera on the tree of life. This is essentially the exact same idea that Pico had, except he was doing it philosophically using linguistics, whereas the Kabbalists are using divine names or angelic orders and a geometrical figure. So it's the same idea in different contexts, but it's allowing them to do essentially the same thing, which is try and behold the entirety of creation from both an individuated, specific perspective and a unified, holistic perspective simultaneously.
Yeah, and I want to give the listeners a little taste here of how Pico talks about this. You know, he's talking about how man must emulate the angels here, and he says this. This is kind of a lengthy quote, so just bear with me. But he says, "How must we proceed and what must we do to realize this ambition? Let us observe what they do, what kind of life they lead. For if we lead this kind of life, and we can, we shall attain their same state. The seraphim burns with the fire of charity. From the cherubim flashes forth the splendor of intelligence. The thrones stand firm with the firmness of justice. If, consequently, in the pursuit of the active life, we govern inferior things by just criteria, we shall be established in the firm position of the thrones. If, freeing ourselves from active care, we devote our time to contemplation, meditating upon the Creator and His work, and the work in its Creator, we shall be resplendent with the light of the cherubim. If we burn with love for the Creator only, His consuming fire will quickly transform us into the flaming likeness of the seraphim. Above the throne, that is, above the just judge, God sits, judge of the ages. Above the cherub, that is, the contemplative spirit, He spreads His wings, nourishing him, as it were, with an enveloping warmth. For the Spirit of the Lord moves upon the waters, those waters which are above the heavens, and which, according to Job, praise the Lord in pre-auroral hymns. Whoever is a seraph, that is a lover, is in God, and God is in him. Even, it may be said, God and he are one. Great is the power of the thrones, which we attain by right judgment. Highest of all the sublimity of the seraphim, which we attain by loving." So I just want people to get a sense of you know, how Pico writes, how he talks about this hierarchy, and what we can do to sort of, you know, kind of capture that same kind of magic that the angels have, I guess. And to be honest, Greg, just like an aside here, for some reason when I was reading through this, this gave me more of an interesting context, I guess, as to the phrase Game of Thrones, which is, that show fascinates me for a bunch of different reasons, but I couldn't help but think of the thrones as... in that way when I was reading through here. So I don't have a question about this. I just wanted to share that. Yeah.
That's interesting, yeah. I think there's no way I could do justice to Pico's brilliant eloquence, the way he expresses himself, the language. Like, he is an expert in linguistics, in putting together the language to not only explain specifically his point so you intellectually grasp it, but he also gives you a sort of a feeling as you're reading it that cannot be communicated. I can't do it. It's like poetry almost. I mean, I know it's prose, but it's such eloquent language that he's obviously a gifted philosopher. But you can see from reading that the way he's gifted in the use of linguistics in communicating not just ideas, but feeling, tone, even sort of conveying, what would you say, like the majesty of certain ideas versus the degradation of others. Like, you can almost feel it when you read his work. It's phenomenal. I mean, he was gifted, truly. And that particular piece, that oration, is really outstanding.
Well, I apologize for all the listeners that I do not share the same gift in reading through his words. But yeah, I just thought that was worth sharing. You know, he also says that, and this is just sort of a nice summary of the angelic hierarchy, is that we can descend to the level of beasts or ascend to the level of angels. So I wanted to go back to, you know, you called him earlier in the conversation the father of Christian Kabbalah. And I was just curious how that title came to be and what his contribution is here.
Yeah, it's a good question. Well, I didn't know much about Pico. How I came to start to learn about him was learning how Kabbalah went from a Jewish tradition to a Christian tradition. And the answer is Pico. He is the first Christian to publicly proclaim it. And he was taught by Christian converts from Spain, and essentially he's the one who facilitated the translation of the first Kabbalistic texts from Hebrew into Latin. So he started the movement. He then influenced Johann Reuchlin from Germany, who went back to Germany and started a movement there known as Christian Hebraism, which was Christians interested in the Old Testament, in the Hebrew language, and in Jewish religious texts. But he was also interested in the Kabbalah as well. Pico then also influenced Agrippa and his three books of occult philosophy, book three of which is primarily concerned with the Kabbalah. So Pico is the origin point of all of this. It's not to say there weren't other Christians earlier in history that, you know, may have known Kabbalah or practiced it, but Pico essentially made it possible and facilitated it as the foundation of Western esotericism. I mean, right in the oration, he talks about how the Kabbalah is the essentially the wisdom tradition. Now I got to find the quote, if you can bear with me just a moment. Okay, Pico says on page 7, "These are the books of the knowledge of Kabbalah. Esdras proclaimed at the beginning in a clear voice that in these books was rightly the heart of understanding, that is, an ineffable theology of supersubstantial deity, the fountain of wisdom, that is, an exact metaphysics of intelligible angels and forms, and the river of knowledge, that is, a most sure philosophy of natural things." And he basically modeled his entire philosophy on the Tree of Life as a way of, as a hierarchical way to behold creation, both at a specific level and in its entirety at the same time. And he embeds the pattern of this hierarchical structure in his very philosophy, because he's trying to mediate, right? And when you think about that, it's very much like the geometry of the Tree of Life, where you have these triangles, where you have two and they mediate to one, right? And it's continual in a structure. So you can have as many ideas as you want, you know? I mean, obviously the Tree of Life is limited to 10 spheres, but the concept can be applied to, as you know, almost infinite number of concepts. And I would say if people are interested in exploring that idea, you should look into artificial intelligence and machine learning. The diagrams that they have to map these out, mirror trees of life, essentially. So this way of approaching knowledge is profound, and Pico recognized that, and, you know, clearly he embraced it. So therefore, he's really not just the father of Kabbalah, of Christian Kabbalah, but he used Kabbalah in a way that was far more subtle and elegant and, in my opinion, sublime than his descendants like Agrippa, for instance. You know, Pico's embedding the structure of the Kabbalah in his philosophy. He's making hidden references to the Hebrew patriarchs and implicitly referring to spheres on the tree of life. I mean, it's very much almost like he's using the patterning of Kabbalah to, as a template to make his own work divine, if that makes sense. So that's a much more profound way of using Kabbalistic ideas, in my opinion, than people who came after him, who look at it much more straightforward, literal, and practical.
His syncretic tendencies are fascinating, but in addition to taking Jewish Kabbalah and sort of mapping it with Christian theology, does he also add portions of the Jewish Kabbalah to Hermeticism?
Well, so Pico's idea of Kabbalah and magic is basically like contemplative mysticism. So his only concern is uniting with God, or the divine, or whatever you want to call it. So he doesn't, and again, like he was not fond of Ficino and his work. So he was busy dissing Hermes Trismegistus at every opportunity. So it was only those that came later that recognized the value of Kabbalah and said, oh, this is the key that we've been missing that we can combine with astrology, with alchemy, with magic, with tarot, and essentially empower it with the ancient wisdom tradition by doing so. But Pico had no interest in that. And I think he would have seen it as certainly not a pursuit that he was interested in, but there's questions about, like, at some point, which, and I think the line may not be clearly defined, but at some point it would cross a line into magic that's concerned with something practical, right? And as soon as it hits that point, like, that's it. That would be the point where he's off the bus, if you will. So he's not interested in combining the Kabbalah with anything other than Christian theology. For him, the Kabbalah reinforces the idea of Christ's miracles, of the divinity of Christ, and what Christ actually is and represents. So that's enough for him. He doesn't have any interest in anything beyond that. It's enough for him to understand that and then to be able to try to, you know, unite with the divine, if you will. You know, it's hard to tease this out. I mean, Pico in his life, just like anyone who's interested in these things, it's like it's easier said than done. Like, it's very easy to be interested in these things, but to actually practice it and do it is an entirely different matter. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's probably best to quote Pico himself here. He says, this is in the part of the oration where he's talking about magic, and he sums up that part where he says, "But enough about magic. I have been led to say even this much, because I know that there are many persons who condemn and hate it, because they do not understand it, just as dogs always bay at strangers." So, I don't know if that actually relates to this part of the conversation, but that I thought was a good quote that I just wanted to throw in there.
Yeah, it's a good quote, for sure.
Yeah, so, you know, we mentioned up front that you said that he was excommunicated for these theses, and I also wanted to share something here. He had a nice observation in his oration where he said, and I'm paraphrasing this one, where he said that any group which attacks valid arguments of reason confirms rather than weakens the truth within the argument. And I don't think that phrase has rang any truer than it does in this story, because you have a guy trying to reconcile truth who's kicked out of the church for doing so. It's also a good phrase to toss around here now, probably in 2018, especially when most valid arguments are rebutted with mostly ad hominem attacks, you know, attacks on someone's character rather than the actual point they're trying to make. So I don't have
really good point, because Pico actually talks about this specifically in the oration, and it definitely applies exactly to what you're saying in terms of the way people can't seem to argue today on like merits as opposed to attacking each other. So what did he say? Pico wrote in the oration, he said, "To those who slander this practice of disputing publicly, I am not going to say much, except that this crime, if they judge it a crime, is the joint work not only of all you very excellent doctors," he's talking about the church doctors, "who have often discharged this office not without very great praise and glory, but also of Plato and Aristotle and the most upright philosophers of every age, together with me. To them it was most certain that they had nothing better for reaching the knowledge of the truth which they sought than that they be very often in the exercise of disputing. As through gymnastics the forces of the body are strengthened, so doubtless in this, as it were, literary gymnasium, the forces of the soul become much stronger and more vigorous. I would not believe that the poets signified anything else to us by the celebrated arms of Pallas, where the Hebrews, when they say Bartzel, iron, is the symbol of wise men, then that this sort of contest is very honorable, exceedingly necessary for gaining wisdom. Perhaps that is why the Chaldeans, too, desire that at the birth of him who is to become a philosopher, Mars should behold Mercury with triangular aspect, as if to say that if you take away these encounters, these wars, then all philosophy will become drowsy and sleepy." And I think he also talks about the idea that, you know, in ancient times, like, the kings would have, like, beasts fight for them, you know, and that's how, like, Rabbi Nachman talks about this, who's a Jewish Kabbalist, great sage, and he talks about how the just like kings of old enjoyed sport of beasts fighting for their pleasure, the divine takes pleasure in these sorts of disputes, these philosophical and religious verbal disputes.
You know, I had two thoughts while you were reading through that. The first one was, you read Pico much better than I do, and I'm kind of jealous of that. But the second one was, man, it really seems like times have not changed much since the late 1400s.
Yeah, in many ways, the human mind is never really changes. Like, it functions the same way. And the root of the problem is essentially the same in any age, right? It's that we take ourselves to be a subject in a world of objects. That's the problem situation.
That's an interesting way to look at it, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Pico's essentially, he's talking about divine union. So he's talking about no more subjectivity and objectivity, the total elimination of that. So you're right. Yeah, it never changes, because the problem situation is always the exact same problem situation, and the solution is always the exact same solution. So
yeah,
kind of refers back to itself in this idea of the ageless wisdom or the perennial philosophy. Like, this is why it is ageless. This is why it's perennial.
So, Greg Kaminsky, your Occult of Personality podcast, obviously, wherever you can find podcasts, I imagine, and the website for that is
OccultofPersonality.net.
There you go. Dude, really enjoyed the chat. Your passion and knowledge of a guy like Pico and all of his ideas is fascinating to me. It's also pretty admirable that you've got to this depth with this guy who continues to be one of the more fascinating figures in the occult culture, or the history of it, I suppose. So Thanks for being here, Greg. I really do appreciate your time. I would love to chat with you again sometime soon about anything.
Yeah, thank you, Ryan. It's really a pleasure to speak with you, and I appreciate the opportunity. And I just want to mention again, it did take a number of years of work to get to the point where I even could have this conversation. And I have to say, there's so many people who have taught me and supported me and worked with me to allow that to happen. It's certainly in no way a solo effort. And especially the members of chamberofreflection.com and supporting the podcast, you know, they allowed me to do things like go back to school and work on my thesis about Pico and share that information with them. And I'm incredibly grateful, because otherwise we wouldn't even be having this conversation.
Yeah, we should have mentioned that, or at least I should have, but your thesis is not published, but...
My thesis is really the basis for everything we've been talking about here.
Definitely, yeah. So hopefully, you know, whenever you get to the end point of that, I hope to stumble across it somewhere. So Greg, thanks again for your time. I really do appreciate it. Take care of yourself, man.
Yeah, thank you, Ryan. Thanks again.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Greg Kaminsky. Love his passion for Pico and his work. It's contagious, or it is to me anyway. I think this one makes a good prequel to episode 77 with Jason Louv. Pico laid the intellectual, philosophical, and spiritual foundation for John Dee's Empire of Angels and everything that came after. Of course, we can speculate on if we've actually made progress since then, but I'll leave that up to you to decide. My main takeaway from this one, like I said, Greg quotes Pico way better than I do, and that's why he's the esoteric podcaster extraordinaire, and I'm still quoting rap songs and running from fire-breathing dragons in this Game of Thrones. Speaking of Game of Thrones, we got realer than real deal Holyfield last time out with Recluse, rolled a bit on the conspiracy side of things. I haven't heard any negative feedback from that episode, but I know conspiracy is not everyone's flavor of choice. It's not mine anymore either, to be honest, but that was a story I've been wanting to tell for a while. I didn't want my paranoia to get in the way of it, I guess, and I got pretty paranoid about posting it, to be honest, to the point where I almost just scrapped the whole thing. Both because it's in opposition to my usual message, which is one of self-empowerment, and because of the details of the content as well. If anything, it's a heat check, for me and for you, and we need a couple of those every now and then. There was a Patreon extension for this episode with Greg. We talk about Pico's death, in which murder seems to be the case that they gave him based on recent evidence. Greg and I speculate on who would have wanted him dead and why, and what the legacy of Pico is. Greg described him as dangerous. Touch a little bit on how Pico's work did set the stage for John Dee and the scientific revolution, which I alluded to earlier. And ultimately, how Pico's oration provides us with a complete guide to spiritual ascension. And I think it's well worth $2 a month to hear that and all the other forthcoming Patreon extensions. There'll never be any set length. Sometimes they'll be an hour, sometimes they'll be 30, sometimes they'll be 15 minutes. It's just kind of how the timing works out. Not everybody wants to chat for 2 hours or 3 hours or however long. And speaking of the old Patreon, my thanks to Janelle, Kat, Arena, Skylar, David G., and Adam for joining the campaign recently. And huge thanks to Mike, Bruce, and David B. for increasing their donations. Those three gentlemen are all official executive producers of the show. And you can join all those fine folks in supporting this endeavor of mine. Where else will you get an hour-long episode about a Renaissance philosopher bookended by gangster rap references? Of course, that may be a reason not to support this, but if you want to, patreon.com/occulture is the place to show some love. And when you support the show, you also get access to our Discord server. Few of us have been chatting in there recently. There's a lot of good behind-the-scenes info I toss out if you're into that sort of thing. Some good conversation, too, that I usually kill by forgetting to reply, because I'm not married to my phone and, you know, I don't check the app all the time. But really, it's about connecting with other listeners who are on similar journeys. And again, you can sign up at patreon.com/occulture. Anyway, no more Indo gin and juice for me. I'm on my way to Chino, rolling on the Grey Goose. Shackled from head to toe, 34 with an Izzo nowhere to gizzo. So just chill till the next episode. Until then, Jesus, I need a life. Until then, you've just been initiated into occulture. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority. We'll be right back.
Please rewind this cassette.